a Savior that's interceding for us, and we have a church family to help us and encourage us. Lord, I can't imagine walking through the storms of life without all of that. So we pray for someone here today that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, that today be that day. We give you thanks for that. We thank you for this time of offering. We pray that you would bless it to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name, all God's people say.
So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work so you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. If you don't know what you're doing, pray to the Father. He loves to help. You'll get his help and won't be condescended to when you ask for it. Ask boldly, believing without a second thought. People who worry your prayers are like wind-whipped waves. Don't think they're going to get anything from the Master that way. Adrift at sea, keeping all your options open. So praise the Lord that in the eyes of our storm, we have a God who's, how great thou art. Amen. It's a great Great rendition, by the way. Great rendition. Outstanding. I don't know how you can move your fingers that way. Your feet too. And you're all kind of confused. Amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 14. I want you to stand in line with the reading of God's word. We're going to talk a little bit this morning about weathering the storms of life. Weathering the storms of life. The Bible says in verse 22, immediately, meaning right now, urgently, he, Jesus, made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. After dismissing the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray, and when evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already over a mile from land, battered by the waves because the wind was against them. Around 3 a.m, Jesus came toward them walking on the sea, and when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost," and they cried out in fear. Immediately again, Jesus spoke to them, "Have courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter answered him, "command me to come to you on the water." "Come on," he said. And climbing out of the boat, Peter started walking on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the strength of the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand, caught hold of him, and said to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those in the boat worshipped him and said, "Truly, you are the Son of God." May one have a blessing for reading, hearing, and doing of his word. You may be seated. If you're like me, it was probably a pretty volatile week, no matter where you were. I was talking to the young folks. They said they had some rain in Cleveland, and obviously it rained quite a bit this week. I was listening to Ben Yobel last night, the 10th worst amount of rainfall on Thursday in Columbus history, 3.4 inches. Millersport on Thursday got 8.5 inches. That's why Interstate 70 was closed both ways for quite some time. This past week, around the state, there were people in places that literally registered more than 11 inches of rain. I mean, I think my flowers are drowning. They look so good, but now they look good at all anymore. They just were so, so bad. And so this morning, I want to talk to you about a storm story. It's interesting, in the context of the scripture, that you know a little bit about what happens when they were on the Sea of Galilee. How many of you have ever been to Israel and seen and been on the Sea of Galilee? So at least a couple, yeah. I have not yet been, but I plan on going next spring. And then hopefully I'll go again in 2019. But one of the things as I was studying this week is a reminder that the Sea of Galilee is actually the lowest freshwater lake in the entire world. In fact, it's the second lowest lake of any kind in the entire world. The only thing lower is the Dead Sea, and it's interesting because the Jordan River flows into the Sea of Galilee from the north, and then in the south it flows down toward the Dead Sea. And it sits in what they know over there is called the Rift Valley, surrounded by hills, and I'm sure you could probably give a much better description because your eyes have seen it. And one of the things that the Sea of Galilee is known for is sudden, turbulent, violent storms. Now, I can relate to that a little bit growing up in Chicago and being on Lake Michigan at times when you would see a storm way out there and in a moment's time before you could literally get out of the water and onto the rocks and off the, you know, off of Lakeshore Drive. I mean, those storms would just bam upon you. This past Monday, I had the privilege of hosting 80 guys and a team from FBC Lancaster was there for our second annual Ohio Baptist Foundation golf outing here. Wedgewood Country Club in the northwest part of Columbus. And we teed off about 15 minutes early. So from about 11:15 till 3 o'clock, it was a great day. It was overcast, it was a little bit of breeze, it was very humid, and then all of a sudden the humidity came. And then the pro had warned us prior to that if something happened because of the volatile weather that was coming, he would blow the horn and get us off the course. So he blew the horn, we got off the course, and so we were off the course for about an hour. And one of the interesting things about being that, we all drove up underneath an overhang, but they just put a new deck on that. And the only bad thing is there was about maybe an inch and a half or 2 inch gap between each piece of board. So as we were sitting in our carts, we had to take umbrellas because the rain was just pounding down on us as we were in there. And then the sun came out and went. Okay, just as beautiful as all could be. We were about an hour delayed, and so 4 o'clock, we get back on the course, and things were fine until about 4:50. And about 4:50, there was just this one little sail. We could hear it kind of rumbling in the distance. And in a matter of about 3 minutes, bam. Now, I was fortunate enough to get in and stay dry. But we had at least 4 teams that were so wet, they didn't even stay for dinner, didn't stay for prizes. They were so wet, they just got in the car, texted me and said, sorry, but we are just rain drenched, and you guys got a little bit wet out there, soaking wet.
Damp.
Damp, yeah. And so, as we think about life, a storm from a physical perspective, the definition is just an agitated turbulence that is normally accompanied by heavy rain, by lightning, by thunder, or by snow. In fact, Gelber said last night that the amount of rain that we got in central Ohio this week would be the equivalent to 5 to 10 feet of snow that the Colorado Rocky Mountains get every winter. So you can imagine the runoff, and of course, you know, 7 was closed, and by my house, there were roads underwater the whole time. So very interesting. So as we think about this text, I want to make 4 observations with you, and then just share with you maybe a couple of simple truths at the very end that we can apply to our lives. First thing I want you to know about the text is that, and in our lives, that storms come. And they come like that. That's why James says, don't be surprised when they come. In fact, count it joy when they come. Now, we've talked about physical storms, the things that are atmospheric or the things of nature. And if you study the Bible closely, you'll find that there were times that God sent storms. If you'll remember over there in Exodus chapter 9, in verses 23 through 25, there was, as the nation of Israel was doing some, as Moses had come back and was delivering the nation of Israel from the bondage of Egypt, one of the plagues was that God sent a fire and a hailstorm of rain upon Pharaoh so that he might get the idea that he should let my people go, and eventually he did. So God rains on us at times. Joshua 10:11 says it this way, that while they were fighting, when the Israelites were fighting with the nation of Israel, and there were thousands and thousands killed in the battle, but during the midst of the battle, God sent a fiery rain, and the Bible's commentary there in Exodus says that there were more, in Joshua, there were more people who died from the rain that God sent than the actual battle using swords. You'll remember over there in Matthew chapter 7, it says if you're going to be a wise person, you build your life on the rock, the foundation of Christ. You don't build your life on the sand, because when you build your life on the sand, what happens? The rains come, and they'll wash your life out, or they'll wash your home out in that context. And so storms come, but there are storms, and we experienced them this week. No matter where you were in Ohio, you probably experienced some storms this week. But there are other types of storms that come to our life almost every day that aren't atmospheric in nature. This past week, I met with several pastors during the course of the week. One had just gotten word that he had some heart issues. He was having to go in and have a heart cath and do some of those kind of things. And then Friday morning, I had an opportunity to visit one of my former members out at Trinity in Cambridge, who just had a hip replacement. And so oftentimes, the storms of our lives are physical in nature, but they're not atmospheric in nature, and we get all kinds of things that happen to us. If you've been to the doctor, whether you're having surgery, whether you hear about cancer, whether you hear about heart attack, whether you hear about diabetes, whether you hear about mental or physical instabilities, the storms come at us all the time. We know that the Bible teaches us in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, as well as we take care of our bodies, they fall apart. They just do. And it's natural in regard to that, because from the moment we're born, we are dying. And our aches and pains might be a little more for some folks than others. But the reality is that sometimes we have those physical type of storms that come to our lives. And hopefully we don't respond to them in fear, but rather in faith. I think about other things that come to our lives that cause storms, these disturbances in our life, these agitations in our life. It's unfortunate to say, but sometimes people cause our storms. You know, people have a tendency to attack us, or they say things that hurt us, or they talk about us, or they abandon us, or you get in the work environment and they want the job more so than you want the job, or get in the school environment and they want to be more popular than you want to be. And because of that, people sometimes cause storms in our lives, a great deal of anxiety that can take place. I think more importantly, the spiritual things that take place in our life, the spiritual storms. As James said, the trials and the temptations, the misunderstandings, the agitations of our life, the contentions of our life, the divisions of our life, the sin in our lives can cause these storms to come upon us suddenly. And storms can be short in duration or they can be long in duration. And how we respond to them and how we react to them oftentimes determines how we will deal with them, whether in the brevity or the longevity that they last. Remember that John says in John 16, verse 33, that Jesus, as he was telling the apostles shortly before he would leave them, he said, guys, be advised that in this world you will have tribulation. You're going to have storms. But he says, be of good courage, because I have overcome the world. Because I have overcome the world, you will also. So I don't know about you, maybe beyond the physical storms of nature this week, maybe there's a storm brewing in your life right now. Maybe there's something that's causing you some angst. Maybe there's something that's causing you some aggravation or some irritation, and you just don't know how to deal with it. I can tell you this, throw it at the Lord's feet, because the Bible tells us we can cast our cares on him because he cares for us. Throw it at the Lord's feet, because he knows the end of your situation right now. No matter what you're in, he already knows why you're there, he knows what's going on while you're in it, and he knows how to get you through it. And so in the midst of our storms, bring them to the Lord. So storms come. The next thing I want you to notice is that fear comes. Now, I don't know about you, I've never seen a ghost. I've heard some ghost stories along the way, but obviously these guys were fishermen, at least some of them were. They knew the water pretty well. They'd been on that sea before many times. They'd made a living there with most of their life. And so this storm was so violent that they were really not knowing how to deal with it. And so Jesus, who had sent them into the boat ahead of himself, we find that out in the first part of the text. He comes to them walking on the water. Now, when you have fear, how do you respond? And so what is fear? Fear is anxiety caused by some kind of impending danger. That's what the Bible says, and that's also what Webster says, basically the same thing, that fear comes. I remember the first time I was really, really fearful. I've shared this with you before, but quickly, when I was six, I rode my first roller coaster. And it was a great ride for about the first minute. But then after we got out of the tunnel and started going click, click, click up the hill, I was with my sister and brother-in-law, and I literally, young people, began to scream at the top of my lungs, I want my mommy. I want my mommy. Because I knew this was not going to be a good thing. Now, thank goodness the ride got me back, and I love roller coasters to this day. But it scared me to death, initially. Let me share two stories with you in my days as a kid in West Virginia, because my mom's family's from there. My Uncle Herman lived right across from Pink Creek. Pink Creek is a creek that runs pretty much through the whole state of West Virginia. Not real wide, maybe about as wide as from here to the sound booth and places. And so you had to cross over the swinging bridge from the road, which you parked on the gravel. Didn't have parking space, you just enough for a car to come by. You'd park on the gravel road, and maybe we put five or six, you know, single file cars there. You had to walk across the swinging bridge, and it was probably about 15 feet, 10 feet above the water. And then when you got on the other side of the swinging bridge, you had to go probably about another 40 yards to Uncle Herman and Aunt Laura's front door. And so one of the things me and their children, we were close, my brother Ray and I were in close proximity to Debbie and Joelle, and so we would always want to go over there when we were staying in West Virginia, because girls, our cousins were close to us. And so one of the things I used to love to do, because I didn't see them in Chicago, is I used to love to chase for salamanders. And so because of where the, you know, the swinging bridge was, and because of the supports on both ends, so I oftentimes would get my body down in there and be trying to catch these salamanders. And I wasn't very, very successful in doing that, because they were pretty quick. But I remember one time I had my right leg in the water, maybe about just below the knee, and my brother Ray began to scream, get out of the water, get out of the water, get out of the water. So he was fearful for me. thinking, what in the world are you screaming at me to get out of the water? And about the time I finally obeyed his command to me, when I lifted out of the water, the water moccasin that was making a beeline for my leg decided to go the other way. And if you know anything about water moccasins, if you get bit by a water moccasin at my age at that time, it could have been a very, very bad deal for me. So just that fear for Ray and me. Now, about 2 years later, we're telling ghost stories in the kitchen. And they begin, I'm probably about 8 years old, I'm thinking now, maybe nine at the most. And we begin to talk about this half man, half beast who's running the mountains in West Virginia. Of course, on the back side of the house, it was probably only about 20 yards and we went right up the mountain. So we were sitting, you know, here's the back door, right there's the kitchen. The main part of the house was kind of around there, and the bathroom's up there. So in the midst of this story, I'm trying to be tough, and I'm getting a little antsy and a little nervous about this half man, half beast. And he's been known to wrestle around things, and you know, basically this werewolf's on the loose, right? So I'm getting so nervous, I have to go to the restroom, so I go to the restroom. Well, lo and behold, my brother Ray sneaks out the back door, puts on a werewolf face, and I come back into the kitchen, and I'm sitting there with Debbie and Joelle, and our cousin David was also there that evening, and they said, you know what, right, you were in the bathroom, we heard something, what'd you hear? I don't know, we heard kind of a howl, we kind of thought, maybe, oh my goodness. So the house wasn't very high, just one story, and they had put a crate, and so I'm sitting at the table, looking out the window, and lo and behold, my brother Ray jumps up with his werewolf mask. And they're scared, it might be scared me to death. So my first thought was, hey, what? What'd you do? I ran out the front door as if it really was me. It was like it went from me running out the front door. But I'm telling you, the fear in that moment was overwhelming. I think that's why I was able to run so fast, right? The Bible tells us that God can give us a spirit of fear, but rather he gave us a spirit of what? Power, love, and discipline. We find that in 2 Timothy 1:7. So as I think about these guys, what caused them to be fearful? Well, obviously they thought they saw a ghost, so at least the supernatural world at times could have caused them to have fear. Remember that in that day there was a whole lot of demonic action going on. It was a very real thing that was taking place while Jesus walked the earth. And it is a very real thing today. When you go to different countries, demonic activity is very, very evident, maybe more so evident. It's actually very, very, it's happening a lot in America. We just don't see it so clearly. So never lose sight of the fact that there's these demons that are part of those who fell from glory that are constantly trying to do things. And so maybe their fear was called by, you know, maybe it was just the fact that they didn't recognize who it was. You know, sometimes we do that, don't you? Back in the day when I was a kid, when I would throw my clothes over the chair, inevitably if I woke up in the morning or in the middle of the night, looked at the chair and the clothes, I could make some kind of monster out of it. I mean, we've all done that, right? So sometimes we need to be careful because we don't recognize things. Sometimes our fear is just perceived. Remember that Goliath had a pretty good reputation when David showed up on the battlefield, right? His perception was, this guy can't be beat, he's pretty big. But yet David's reality was, with God, I can do anything. And eventually, he overcame the other people's fear. Because remember, as Goliath went out on the mountain there for 40 days and 40 nights, he screamed at them to come and fight. And the Bible says that the men of Israel fled the scene. They took off. They ran. And then Saul didn't do anything about it until David finally showed up. Sometimes our fear comes because our worry outweighs our reality. If you've ever had a kid, especially when children start, young adults start driving for the first time. I can think of times when Jenny and I, when the girls had their keys and we were expecting them home at 10 o'clock, 10:15 came, or 10:20 came. Back in those days, texting wasn't something we did. Cell phones weren't really happening. So, you know, you'll immediately begin to worry, and sometimes that worry turns into fear. You know, sometimes fear comes because of our disobedience. Do you remember at the very beginning of the Bible? You remember Adam and Eve's story? So after they sinned, the Bible says that God had come to them every day, and during the day, in the cool of the day, and have fellowship with them. And remember, after they sin, God calls out to them, Adam, where are you? And he says, well, I hid myself because I was afraid and I'm naked. For in his disobedience, he had a fear of the Lord. And the Bible tells us in more than one place that we should have a reverence for the Lord, because in our disobedience, we should fear his wrath, or at least sometimes his correction. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 12, the Lord does correct those he loves. I don't know about you, but if you've ever heard this statement, you wait until your father gets home. Most likely, there was a little bit of fear that was welling up in your body because the fact that you thought you were really going to get it when dad got home. Sometimes you didn't. Sometimes you're able to talk your way out of it. I also think that sometimes when fear comes, it just causes paralysis. You remember the soldiers at the tomb? When the angels show up, the Bible says that fear came upon them and they fell like what? Dead men. I have this uncanny thing about dreaming things, and it's really kind of weird in my own life, but I have lots of dreams about demonic fights. Literally, I'm fighting demons, demons are chasing me, all those kind of things. And one of the things that is rather interesting in the midst of those is that sometimes I'm very active, meaning I'm in their grill, I'm chasing them or I'm after them. But other times in my dreams, I kind of get paralyzed. Now, I don't know about you, but if you've had a great deal of anxiety at any one time to come upon you, chances are you've gotten paralyzed. Now, when I get paralyzed, I normally start talking. And when my wife says I do that, so if you could imagine, my wife's next to me, it's 2:30, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, and this is what she hears. And I'm shaking because that's normally what I also do. And then she has to hit me or whatever. And there's been a couple of times I thought she was a demon. But the reality is, in our life, sometimes we get fearful. Paralysis. Many of the shootings that took place, especially the shootings that took place, the massacres that took place at Virginia Tech, one of the things that they said in one particular classroom where many students were killed was that when the shooter came in, they all just froze, which made them easy targets, and they lost their lives. So in the midst of our storms of life, they come. They can come quickly. They can be short. They can be long. In the midst of them, sometimes fear comes. But I want you to notice another thing from our text. Not only does fear come, but help has come. Because it's actually Jesus that is coming to them. So Jesus has sent them in the storm. He knows the storm is going to take place. He's now coming to them in the storm. He's going to be with them in the storm. And he's going to get them to the other side to get them through the storm. And so in this context, help comes in the person of Jesus. What does it mean to help someone? It just means an action of assisting someone. Our young people were assisting churches, church plants in Cleveland this week, coming alongside to help them in their ministry needs, whether it was doing some door-to-door witnessing or confronting people with the gospel on the street or just praying with people as they're in the midst of their storms, or if it was doing some painting or doing some construction. So in essence, they were helping. That's part of our go mandate in our mission, that we might go and serve others, so we might go and help others do their ministry, because ministry can be overwhelming for all of us, this church, any church. So one of the things we have to realize is that help comes. And as I couldn't help but thinking, as Scott was praying this morning, he mentioned all the ways that we get our help. We get our help from the Word of God. The Word of God is a great source of strength in the midst of difficulty. If you can begin to memorize Scripture, and the Holy Spirit, when you get in tough situations, will help you remember those. This week I was reminded in a bulletin that I read from a church from last week. It was Proverbs 18:10. The strength of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to him and are safe. So when you get in that difficulty, I know that I can trust in the Lord. I know that the Bible tells us in more than one place, Jesus himself, and then back in Joshua and other places, that Jesus and God say they'll never leave us nor forsake us. So always there's help in the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, Jesus the person, and also God the Father. And also believers, we are helpers one to another, aren't we? Praise the Lord that we have people who can come alongside of us. One of the great things about the body of Christ is that we come to one another and help each other in time of need. That's why the Bible says in Galatians 6:2 that we should bear one another's burdens. That's why the Bible says in Galatians 6:10 that we should practice hospitality, especially to the household of faith. So part of it is that help comes. I'm always mindful and grateful that help has come to Jenny and I in the most difficult of situations, whether it was something that was going on with one of the children, whether it was something that was going on in our life, whether it was something that was going on that no one knew about but God, but yet God sent someone to bring help to us. I've always been grateful for those multiple things. And it's interesting, too, that at least the apostles should have known that Jesus had the ability to walk on the water. The Bible says to us over in Job 9:8, that he alone stretches out the heavens and he treads on the waves of the seas. So it shouldn't have been, oh, it's a ghost. No, it's Jesus, because that's why Peter says, well, Jesus, if it is you, then command me to come to you. And he says, come. Of course, we know he gets out of the boat and walks over to Jesus. We don't know how long he walks, but at least for a moment, he's doing the very thing that the Bible says in the Old Testament Jesus had the power to do. He literally could tread on the waves of the waters. And Psalm 77:19 says, thy way is in the sea, thy paths are in its mighty waters. And so being able to walk on the water should probably not caught them by surprise that they were really in the midst of faith, but of course we know that they had the little faith, and only one of them had enough faith to get out of the boat and walk. I think another thing that helps us is the experience of how God has worked in our lives. He has proved himself faithful to us, so when we get in these storms, we rely upon his faithfulness, even when we are not faithful, amen? He's faithful. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. So in the midst of the storm, as we sing about the eye of the storm, we think about weathering the storms, let's make sure we understand that they do come. They come. They're always coming, or they're always going, or you're always in the midst of them. In the midst of that, if you don't respond well, or you don't recognize well, fear will come. Fear can be overcome by faith, because when we exercise our faith, Jesus comes. Then the last thing I want you to notice is that faith prevails. Faith prevails. So, you know, here's this big storm. Waves. We know that your translation might say many stadium wave, which is about 600 feet, which is about 2 football fields. The ESV says here it was a mile away. So they're a mile out on the water. I've only been on Lake Erie one time in a boat. Big storm came upon us. My brother-in-law had a 22-foot inboard outboard ringer boat. It was a great 195 horse, I think, so we could get out of there if they split. But the only time I've experienced 4 to 5 foot waves while on the water, and I'm a doggone good swimmer, wasn't that day, and I think I could be today. But I can tell you, man, that was very, very concerning, maybe 30 or 40 minutes in the midst of that. And so what do we do when those things come? So Peter says, oh, it's the Lord. Okay, well, Lord, if it is you, tell me to come. So he gets out. And for a moment, he's walking on the water. But we know what? He begins to see the wind. He begins to see the wave. And that's one of the things that causes us to have fear, because we can see it. We can't really understand it. We don't perceive it correctly. We can't see a way to get out of it. And when that takes place, we sink. But praise God, he also, even though he had a little faith, he has great faith, because what takes place when he begins to sing? What does he do? Lord, save me. Help me. And what does Jesus do? Immediately, he stretches out his hand and helps him. So how does faith prevail? Well, in the midst of it, faith prevails when we exercise our courage in Christ. When we exercise our courage in Christ, faith prevails. Doesn't the Bible tell us that we can do all things through who? Christ, who strengthens us. Romans chapter 8 tells us that we are more than what? Conquerors through him who loved us and gave his life for us. And so faith prevails when we exercise courage, because we know that Christ is with us. Many years ago, there was a guy that was considered one of the most feared heavyweights of all time. His name was Mike Tyson. He was undefeated at the time. I knew Buster Douglas. Buster Douglas was a graduate of Mary Franklin High School. And I knew Buster, and I knew John Johnson. And bottom line is, while he was training, one of the things that he said, he had much courage. He said, if I can withstand the first couple rounds, which I think I can beat this guy, because he's not faced anybody my size who can put a left jab in his face continually. And we know that, as far as I know, it's the greatest upset in boxing history. It might have been the greatest upset in any kind of sports history, apart from the gold medal game or the
the semifinal between the Russians and the Americans back in 1980 in the Olympics. But one of the things that Buster had, he said, Jack, I'm not afraid of this guy. I got courage.
And right before the fight, his mom dies. And so he had an additional motivation. And of course, eventually in that February, he knocked Mike Tyson out. And really, Mike Tyson's life has never been the same since then. So that invincibility was lost. Why? Because he had courage. Faith prevailed. Notice also that faith can produce calm. It's interesting, too, that we don't know how far Peter walked. We don't know how far when Jesus and them were walking back. But we know that Jesus was still walking back with them in the storm. Because the winds and the waves don't die down until what? They get back into the boat. And so one of the things that I think we need to understand is that in the midst of our storms, when we walk with the Lord, it can produce calm in our lives. That we don't have to be tossed to and fro by every wind and doctrine of men. That we don't have to be upset. That we can just kick back and relax. I think about two pictures when I think about calm in the midst of the storm. One is that Jesus, on the night that he's betrayed, the night that he's beaten, when he could have cried out for help, when he could have called down a myriad of angels, thousands of them, calm. And sensing anger in his replies to Judas and to Herod as he's going through the Sanhedrin, just calm. Now, was he in pain? Certainly. Was he in a storm? Absolutely. But just calm. Being able to respond calmly. How many of you remember the Left Behind series that Tim LaHaye, the books that he wrote many years ago? Tim LaHaye, late in life, wanted to learn how to become a pilot. And so he went and got his pilot's license, and he was flying for about a year. Oftentimes, he would want Bev to go with him, but Bev had a fear of flying. She said, no, I really don't want to fly, especially, you know, he had a little small Cessna. She said, no, I don't want to fly in a little four-seater if I'm going to fly and all that. And so she never would accompany with him when he would take these, you know, 1, 2, 3 day jaunts to go out and teach something. He was a great teacher to worry about. But on one particular time, he finally talks her in to flying with him. So they get up in the air. They're going along, and like the storms that hit us this week, in the middle of their flight, they're still about an hour away from where they're going to land, they run into a huge storm. Now, Tim's not as seasoned a pilot as others, so he himself has some fear. He himself is thinking, oh my goodness, this is a bad thing. And so in the midst of what he's doing, instrument panels and all that, he loses sight of the fact that his wife is sitting next to him in the cockpit. And he's doing all these things. And when he really thinks, you know, we need to pray here because I think our life might end. He turns and looks at her and she's dead asleep. Just out like a light. He's thinking to himself, what in the world? So they get through. And about the time they're maybe on their descent, she wakes up. Of course, you know, he's white knuckled and white. And she's like, are you all right? And he goes, oh. Didn't know it, we just went through it before. No, but what happened? Oh, this storm, and I thought we were going to die. And I forgot you were there. Then you were sleeping. How can you sleep for such a thing? Here's what she said. She said, well, you know my fear of flying. For the last couple days, I fasted and prayed. Said, Lord, just don't let me be fearful of flying. In fact, just give me a peace that passes all understanding that I might be calm. And obviously, it worked because through the flight, it was just calm as can be. You see, when you place your faith and trust in Jesus in Christ, you're not weak and courage. But he'll give you a peace that passes all understanding. Just calm, calm. And then notice what takes place afterward. There's a celebration in it. That's what worship is. In verse 33, then those in the boat did what? They worshiped. Celebrate. Not only is the storm over, but Jesus is with us in the midst of the storm. Isn't that what we just sang? The eye. The storm. His love surrounds us. In the middle of the battle, in the middle of the war, he is with us. And so, faith always prevails. How do I know that? Because the Bible says I can have the confidence. Philippians 1 said it this way, that I'm confident in this one thing, that he who began the work in me is able to bring it to completion in the person of the Lord Jesus. You lack confidence? Ask the Lord for it. Throw yourself upon him.
The Bible also tells us in Hebrews 11:1 about we can have confidence because what? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, we need to walk by faith, not by sight. And we know that the Bible also tells us over there in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8 that we are saved by grace. It's not of ourselves. What? We're saved by grace through faith. It's not our works. We can't boast about that. Only God's grace and our exercise of faith gives us the confidence to prevail. To prevail. So, think of it this way. I don't know if you're in a storm, you just come out of a storm, you're taking a break from the storm, but there's a storm coming. It's just a matter of when it's going to get to you. It's going to come. It might come suddenly, it might come subtly, but it's going to come one way or the other. In the midst of that, let me encourage you by God's word, don't be fearful. Don't be fearful. Oftentimes, because we don't know the outcome, that's what the anxiety gets within us. But yet, if we're in the palm of God's hand, anything that comes our way has to be a benefit for us, or God wouldn't let it come our way. In the midst of that, remember that His help is always available. All you got to do is say, Lord, save me. Lord, help me. Lord, come to my aid. And when you do that, because He can produce courage and calm and cause your life to be a celebration, your faith will prevail. Now, there's a story told that from a guy. I was a Cub Scout at the time. It was a Boy Scout troop. And so there was a place up in Michigan that had some cliffs, and we were there in a camp. And so as we got to this one really nice freshwater stream, we noticed that about maybe 70 to 75 feet above the water was a little cliff ledge. And so us Cub Scouts couldn't go. We weren't allowed. But there were a couple of Boy Scouts that thought, you know what? That looks like it would be fun to jump off of that. Now, I've jumped from 42 feet. When you get to 42 feet, look down, that's a long way. I couldn't imagine 75 feet. And what I know about how your body is supposed to be in a position when you enter the water, if you don't enter the water well, you can do damage to your body. Way back in the day at Eccles Lake, outside of Delaware, Ohio, they had this kind of gymnasium on water. And they had these, basically they were Olympic rings that you could run off of a hill that's about 40 yards, or about 40 feet here, and you can swing out. And by the time, if you got a really good run, you can swing up to maybe 45 feet or so. And I remember one time doing that, kind of got out of position and upside down, and instead of hitting the water like that, like I'm supposed to, I hit the water like that with my face up and ripped my mouth across the bottom. I had 3 stitches on the inside of my lip. So these Boy Scouts go, man, that would be fun. So they got to go through all these briars, and it took about 15 minutes to get there. But I remember one of them saying, as he was telling the story later, he said, you know, once I got up there, I had a little bit of anxiety, a little bit of fear. Thinking, man, that's a long way down there. I might be able to hurt myself. But the more he thought about it, here's what he said. I realized I had to face my fears. I had to embrace this adventure. And then I had to take the plunge. And so he did that. Yeah. And so as we lived this life, he said it was exhilarating, you know, having done it. And he went and did it many more times when they could go back to that. So here's maybe the principle. When the storms of life come and the fears maybe seem to overwhelm you, focus on God's power, not the problem you're in. Focus on God's power, not the problem you're in. Because greater is He that's within you than He that's within the world. He can make it happen. He is in you. He is for you. He is working on your behalf. So no matter what life brings your way, and I've lived long enough to know that there's all kinds of storms that come all kinds of ways, at all kinds of times. But I can tell you, in the midst of them, Christ has never failed to show up in mighty power. So the key for life, if you're going through storms, they're going to come. Fear is going to come sometimes. Jesus is going to come in the midst. He's going to be right in the middle of it with you. And if your faith will prevail, just remember, focus on Him. Life is an adventure, isn't it? Think about what would happen if we didn't take the plunge. As the old saying is, if you're I'm thinking of the old story as the guy's hanging off the cliff, right? And he's going, God help me, God help me, God help me. Jesus shows up, line. God help him, God help him. Jesus shows up and says, hey, I'm Jesus. I'm here to help. He goes, oh, I'm so grateful. Help me out. He goes, no, how about letting go? What do you mean? Let go. I'm here to help you. That's where the rubber of the road meets faith then. So let go. Let God. Because he'll make sure you won't be crushed or fall. That's great. Father, we know that there are storms in our lives. They're always there. Our minds are racing 90 miles an hour every day. There's difficulty that is coming every day. There's challenges that we face every day. Some we understand, some we don't. Some we like, some we don't. Some that we think are going to help, and then maybe they don't. So there's all these kind of things going on in our lives all the time. You know that very, very well. I pray this morning that as they do come, and as we've been reminded, even in the physical storms of this week, how quickly they can come and how violent they can be. Even in the midst of those things in our own personal lives, that there's still the next day. There might be weeping for a night, but joy comes again. That you're there with us. You're providing an opportunity. You're bringing the boat. You're bringing you're bringing someone. You're bringing something to help us in the midst of these storms. So I pray for those who are in the sanctuary today that are going through storms. Maybe it's just storms and just difficulty of physical things going on in your life, or maybe physical things going on in some of your family's life or their friends, or maybe it's an emotional thing that they're fighting with, it's a broken relationship, it's all kinds of things. I pray this morning that they would reassure to their spirit that you are with them. As you tell us in your word, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow, that you are with us, your rod and your staff, they comfort us. And even in the presence of our great enemy, so as we respond to you this morning, glorify yourself. We'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you're here this morning and you're going to have a personal relationship with this Jesus, this helper, I would encourage you to get up in just a second. Come take it by the hand. Let me share with you how you can become a Christ follower, that you can have this great comfort in this storm. Christians, the altar is always open. Feel free to come and pray with one another. If you need to make a decision, baptism, membership, whatever that might be, I'll be waiting for you. Y'all come as we stand and sing.
Yeah.
covered all. Did I cover all?
So this week, trust the Lord in your storm, right? And you go through the highways and byways of life. If you see somebody in a storm,